Hi, I'm Ernie Harwell, voice of the Detroit Tigers. On this, the most American of all holidays, the 4th of July, ESPN has a special celebration, a baseball tripleheader. So, along with your barbecues, picnics, and family reunions, let's all enjoy our national pastime. The folks at ESPN have asked me to salute the 4th of July with my baseball definition. This is a tribute that I wrote back in 1955, and I know that the names of the heroes have changed over the years, but I think that the spirit of the game remains the same. I called it the game for all America. I hope you enjoy it. Baseball is a president tossing out the first ball of the season and a scrubby schoolboy playing catch with his dad on a Mississippi farm. It's a colorful character called Casey who steered his Yankee ship to 10 pennants in 12 years. And it's a silver-haired skipper named Sparky winning it all with a team in each league. Baseball is a big fat guy with a bulbous nose running home one of his 714 home runs. It's also the proud, quiet man who broke that record one night in Atlanta. And it's a tiger named Cecil who, some say, owns the future. There's a man in San Juan who was there when the great Roberto Clemente lashed one off the wall in 1971. And in Oakland is a player for all time and every fan. Equal part, slugger, showman, and cat burglar. Baseball is a spirited race of man against man, reflex against reflex, a game of inches. Every skill is measured, every heroic, every failing is seen and cheered or booed, and then becomes a statistic. In baseball, democracy shines its clearest. The only race that matters is the race for the bag. The creed is a rule book, and color merely something to distinguish one team's uniform from another. Baseball is a rookie, his experience no bigger than the lump at his throat as he begins fulfillment of his dreams. It's a veteran, too, a tired old man of 35, hoping that those aching muscles can pull him through another sweltering August and September. Nicknames of baseball, childhood names like Spanky and Pudge and Doc, or names born in the press box and broadcast booth, names like The Thrill, Strawman, and Hawk. Baseball is the cool, menacing eyes of Dave Stewart, or the baby blues of a Baltimore Oriole, siding in on the Iron Horse's ancient record. It's the hot, vivid language of a manager known as Sweet Lou. Baseball, just the game, as simple as a ball and bat, and yet as complex as the American spirit it symbolizes. It's a sport, a business, and sometimes almost even a religion. The fairy tale of Willie Mays making a brilliant World Series catch, then dashing off to play stickball in the streets with his teenage pals. That's baseball. So it's a husky voice of a doomed Lou Gehrig saying,
I consider myself the luckiest man on the face of the earth.
Baseball is cigar smoke, hot roasted peanuts, down in front, the seventh inning stretch. Take me out to the ball game and the Star-Spangled Banner. Baseball is a game for the ages, as durable as the land, or a 44-year-old Texas rancher named Nolan, who is still climbing the hill and staring down batters half his age, still delivering his express on schedule, still lengthening his legend as the greatest strikeout pitcher of all time. This is a game for America, still a game for America, this baseball.
Baltimore Orioles face New York here on Major League Baseball, the holiday edition on ESPN. Some of you will join the bleacher bums at Wrigley Field in Chicago where the Pirates are set to face the Cubs. Happy holidays, everyone, and welcome to ESPN's special 4th of July tripleheader of Major League Baseball. I'm Gary Miller. We'll be getting into the ballparks in just a minute after we set the scene around the game. Tuesday, Nolan Ryan set yet another Major League record with his 25th straight 100 strikeout season. But as happened so frequently for the 44-year-old this season, there are complications. Ryan spent 3 hours in an Arlington hospital Wednesday morning complaining of chest pain, but a battery of tests revealed no cardiac problems, and he's been diagnosed as having a strained sternum. By the afternoon, he had re-immersed in his rigorous exercise program. He's expected to make his next scheduled start Sunday when they host the Angels. The Rangers are just two out in the AL West, but there's a new leader. The Angels, having overhauled the slumping Twins late last night by 1/1000th of a percentage point, five teams within 5.5 of the lead. By this afternoon, the Twins could regain the lead. They're up 1-0 on a Junior Ortiz fielder's choice. It's West against Key as they play at the Sky Dome in the bottom of the second. We'll keep you up to date on that game, as well as the action in Yankee Stadium and Wrigley. And a reminder, it's Tripleheader Day. We're with you throughout the day, resuming at 7 Eastern time. Enjoy your holiday here on the 4th. We're going to the ballpark.
What better way to spend and celebrate America's birthday than with America's pastime? And today on ESPN, it's a Major League Baseball tripleheader. Game one from Yankee Stadium as the Baltimore Orioles are in town to take on the resurgent New York Yankees. Hi, everybody. I'm Steve Zabriskie. Welcome to our ESPN 4th of July tripleheader, and a happy 4th of July to you all. Well, I guess Yankee Stadium, one of the three parks you might want to be in on the 4th of July because of the great history here, along with Wrigley Field and Fenway Park. And it looks as if perhaps the long-awaited Yankee turnaround may be beginning to happen. The Yankees have won 5 in a row. They've won 8 of their last 9 games. And here's one of the big reasons why. These three young pitchers, whose names you probably will not recognize, with Jeff Johnson going today, have done a terrific job. And as we turn to my partner, Tommy Hutton, Tommy, even though they don't have big names, they're doing it.
Yeah, they're doing it, and they also do it with different styles. Jeff Johnson this afternoon, a left-hander with a sinker ball, a little bit of a change-up, and will change speeds. Taylor and Kamenicki, right-handers, who throw the ball hard. There are other reasons, though, the Yankees have played well recently. Power, they're third in the major leagues in home runs, and they also have a better attitude.
Well, the Baltimore Orioles could use a little of that attitude. They have struggled tremendously this year, but one thing everybody is talking about, aside from the streak, is the play this season of Cal Ripken. What a year he's having.
One thing that's always a constant with the Orioles is Ripken is shortstop. He's been around 350 all season. Cal Ripken has over 100 base hits. He's reached 100 hits faster than any Baltimore Oriole in the history of their franchise. He's only struck out 21 times. The Orioles got off to a terrible start. They were 13-28. They've played a lot better lately. Lately, they're 18-17, a game over 500 in the AL East. That's not that bad.
Here's the starting lineup and batting order for the visiting Orioles today. Mike Devereaux, who hits very well in Yankee Stadium, will lead off and play center field. Tim Hewlett will be the designated hitter today and bat second. Cal Ripken, leading the American League in hitting, will be at shortstop as usual and hit third. The Moose, Randy Milligan at first base, batting fourth. Rookie third baseman Leo Gomez will bat fifth. Chris Hoyles, with a fine arm behind the plate, catches and bats sixth. Joe Arcelak moves to left field and hits seventh today. Rookie right fielder David Segee will hit eighth. And Billy Ripken at second base and batting ninth.
There's a look at the 24-year-old left-hander, Jeff Johnson. At this time last year, he was toiling in the Florida State League for the Fort Lauderdale Yankees. This afternoon on July 4th, he's at Yankee Stadium wearing the pinstripes. Sinker ball, not overpowering, don't expect a lot of strikeouts, and he shouldn't walk too many either. Behind the plate is Matt Noakes, who not only has been catching well, but hitting extremely well, and you could say that about a lot of the Yankee hitters. The rest of the infield for the Yankees this afternoon, Mattingly, Sachs, Espinosa, the youngster Pat Kelly, who improves with each game at the third base. The outfield, Hall and Kelly. Jesse Barfield, with his 10 assists this year, has 159 for his career.
And that is second among active players, Dave Winfield, with 160 outfield assists. Mike Devereaux is going to lead it off on this magnificent day, and today the Yankees are entertaining 10,000 U.S. service personnel and their families at the ballpark on the 4th of July in an effort to aid and to welcome home of the Desert Storm troops. What a better day, or there really isn't any better day to do it than on this patriotic holiday, and what a day it is. Warm, a little bit of a humidity that feels higher than 51%. The wind is really not much of a factor.
But you know what, Steve? You and I are both used to that humidity.
Right, because we live in Florida. This doesn't feel that bad, actually. But it does feel a little higher than 51%. All in all, a super day. Mike Devereaux, hitting .264, but for his career in Yankee Stadium, he's hitting .375. And a strike on the outside corner as Jeff Johnson, the rookie left-hander, gets to work. Fouled out of play. 0-2.
It's really amazing when you think of the young staff of the Yankees with Devereaux up there. I think one of the reasons Devereaux's hit well at Yankee Stadium, he's a line drive type hitter. If you're a right-handed power hitter, you might not fare well here in the spacious Yankee Stadium.
A fastball grounded at third. Pat Kelly throws out Devereaux, one away.
Well, we mentioned Pat Kelly, and if you're a youngster learning a new position, I guess the guy you'd like to learn it from would be Greg Nettles. And that's who works with Pat Kelly.
Nettles, the first base coach and infield instructor for the Yankees. Here's the Orioles DH today, Tim Hewlett, hitting just .207 with 6 homers and 13 RBIs. One of the reasons his average is down to .207, for the month of June, or most of it anyway, he hit an abysmal .103. And he takes a fastball right in there for strike one.
Talking to Johnny Oates about Tim Hewlett. Johnny Oates now getting used to the managerial position with the Orioles. He said Hewlett's the type of player that if you use him correctly, you're going to get good production. But if all of a sudden you have to use him 2 weeks in a row, then he notices the production falls.
Hard on the ground to second. Steve Sachs with an easy play and two away. Well, that doesn't bode well for a guy who'd like to be in the lineup every day, as most young players strive for. Speaking of being in the lineup every day, how about Cal? He's got about 4 seasons of continuing this streak before he gets to Lou Gehrig's all-time record. But this is 1,488 in a row. When you really want to put that in perspective, think about where guys he's now playing with were when the streak began. Some of his teammates were in junior high school when this streak started. Not when his career started, when the streak started. A little bit low.
This is almost like a day off, too, for him, because the Orioles got into town late last night, so Johnny Oates didn't have batting practice or infield practice. So for Cal Ripken, kind of a day off for him. All he has to do is play 9.
Base hit left field. What a groove he is in. Leading the American League in hitting. And he has now hit in 11 of his last 12 games. A 2-out single for Cal.
Now we talked about his consistency, and the reason he's done that, he quit experimenting. He said he experimented too much last year with his stroke. This year he's gotten a little more of a crouch. Too stand-up-ish last year. How about that? Stand-up-ish.
They got him picked off. He got leaning the wrong way, and Mattingly chases him down, and the inning is over. So he was stand-up-ish, and now he's picked off-ish.
Good move. We know that Johnson has a good move. Now the Orioles will know that for the next 8 innings.
And you don't see that from Ripken too often, even though he's not super fast. He's a pretty good base runner.
He caught him between hops. Instead of taking the little steps to take the lead, he caught him between hops.
One hit, but nobody left here in the first half of the first inning. Welcome back to Yankee Stadium, and wherever you may be on this 4th of July, we hope that the weather is at least almost as good as it is here today, because it is magnificent. And here is the batting order for the Yankees. Second baseman Steve Sachs leads it off. The center fielder Roberto Kelly bats second. Red-hot Don Mattingly will be batting third. Left fielder Mel Hall in the cleanup spot. The DH today in batting fifth, Kevin Moss. Jesse Barfield, the right fielder, bats sixth. The catcher, Matty Noakes, will hit seventh. Alvaro Espinosa, the shortstop, batting eighth. And rookie third baseman Pat Kelly bats ninth.
Now pitching this afternoon for Baltimore, 29-year-old right-hander Roy Smith. He's familiar in this territory. Went to Mount Vernon High School, graduated from Fordham University. So he'll have some fans out. All four pitches, but his best pitch, big over-the-top curveball. Youngster behind the plate is Chris Hoyles, Bob Melvin, and Ernie Witt. Other catchers on the ball club. Hoyles has had a good percentage in throwing out base runners. In the infield for Baltimore this afternoon, many first basemen on their roster. Randy Milliken is settled in over there right now. Billy and Cal up the middle, and Leo Gomez at third. Mike Devereaux will anchor things in the outfield. Joe Orsulak in left, Segui in right. You might wonder why. Segui new to the outfield. Orsulak's probably the better of the two, but there's more room in left field at Yankee Stadium. Oates wanted him out there.
Ordinarily, right field is a more difficult position to play in most ballparks, but here, a lot more room in left, and Orsulak runs better. Steve Sachs leads it off, having a good year, hitting .292, four homers, 28 RBIs, and 13 stolen bases. He's also got a nine-game hitting streak going, over which he's hit .421.
Roy Smith with that fastball that he'll rise. It's not an overpowering fastball, but sometimes it looks faster because he has that big over-the-top curveball to go along with it.
And a fastball popped up and may be playable. Chris Hoyle stays with it and makes the catch on the way.
Hey, Hoyle's had all kinds of things to contend with over near the on-deck circle. Roberto Kelly, the on-deck hitter, scurrying out of the way. Pine tar rags, leaded donuts, rosin bags, everything over there.
Plus a swirling wind behind home plate here at Yankee Stadium. The wind has a tendency to come in and swirl around and makes pop-ups sometimes an adventure. Roberto hitting .261. Takes a fastball for a strike.
I'll tell you one of the things I think Steve really got the Yankees going, a sweep of the Red Sox not too long ago, Fenway Park. There's that big, slow curve.
You're not kidding, that big and overhand.
Johnny Oates had a great story. He was talking about Roy Smith pitching against the Red Sox, and he said Brunansky and Clark, Roy Smith got him with that big curveball, got each of them a couple of times. He said they broke more bats going back to the dugout, smashing it down on the ground, than they did getting jammed on a fastball.
It's frustration. Fastball just outside. I'll tell you what, that Uncle Charlie has created more insurance salesmen than anything else. A lot of guys in the minor leagues and in amateur baseball hit the heck out of the ball, and they don't see that big league breaking ball, and they get here, and it has a tendency to affect their career negatively.
That was the old line they used to use years ago. Kid had ride home, he'd tell his mom, don't rent the room, they're starting to throw curveballs.
<That's right. laughs> I may not be here long. There is a fastball hit deep to left, but it'll stay in the park. Orsulak for out number two.
And an example already of Joe Orsulak, the move that Johnny Oates made in putting him in left field as opposed to his normal right field. One of the best at Yankee Stadium over the years. It rambled around out there. Roy White. Not only did he get some key hits, he could play left field here.
Here's a guy that can play first base and also swing that stick. He takes that breaking ball for a strike. Don Mattingly now hitting .311. In the last 36 games, he's hit .342, and he has been on base with either a hit or a walk all 36 games. And that's what you expect from Mattingly, the high on-base percentage, not a lot of strikeouts, enough power, and a lot of line drives. Two and one.
Notice he's hitting third, too. There was a time where The Yankees and Stump Merrill experimented and moved Mattingly in the number two spot.
Just outside. 3-1.
But he felt that Mattingly himself feels more comfortable hitting third. Kelly settled into number two and sacks a good leadoff man.
There's a rope to center field, but right there is Mike Devereaux, and the inning is over. The Yankees go in order in the first. No score after one. Gary, it's a good cause, and since Tommy and I, neither one of us pitched, who cares what the pitchers think?
Go for it. Long ball. Let's go.
Take him deep. I don't care. Here's a guy who can do it. Moose Milligan. Randy hitting 280 with 9 homers and 37 RBIs. He had a very slow start, but has really picked up the pace, hitting 488 in his last 12 games, or 10 games, rather. There's a strike at the knees on the outside corner, 2-1.
Randy Milligan extremely patient as a hitter, so he makes a pitcher work. He makes a pitcher come into the strike zone.
He did right there.
However, one of the knocks, it's always a fine line, one of the knocks on him, maybe too patient. That pitch there looked like a good pitch to hit.
And you want that power hitter to be aggressive. 3-2. It is a fine line, Tommy, because if you hit deeper in the count and see more pitches, you usually have more success. All you have to do is look at a guy like Wade Boggs to see that that's the case. Out of play, still 3-2. But a guy who can really drive the ball, and we've talked about this before, ordinarily you're going to see maybe one pitch during an at-bat that you can really drive.
And if he sees that pitch early in the count, he needs to drive, because they need to depend on him for power.
And here he reaches out and punches a base hit through the middle. He didn't get a pitch he could drive, but he got a base hit.
Well, that's how good of a hitter he is. You saw the pitch he fouled off prior to that. That pitch he doesn't swing at early in the count, but he knew he had two strikes. He had to protect the plate, which he did. And even the next pitch that he singled up the middle wasn't a great pitch, but he knew it was a strike. So he is a good, solid hitter. There's no question about that.
So Milligan aboard with nobody out. And here's rookie third baseman Leo Gomez hitting 246. Gomez has been in a terrible slump with only 5 hits in his last 35 at-bats. Ball one. That's a 143 clip. Line drive and a base hit to center field. Milligan will stop at second, and the Orioles have it going in the second with two on and nobody out.
First base coach Kurt Moulton, I'm sure, telling Leo Gomez, hey, this guy has a good move. He already saw him pick off Cal Ripken.
Sometimes a base runner at first has a tendency to get a little lazy, too, because he's not being held on and there is a runner ahead of him.
Sometimes a first base coach will tell the runner, first and second situation, you watch the pitcher, I'll watch the first baseman.
Chris Hoyle's the hitter, hitting 221. Down low.
One thing we know for sure, we probably won't see a complete game this afternoon. Orioles have two and the Yankees have two.
Right.
Both these teams dip into the pen.
We've played over 75 games already this year.
Sometimes they dip in because they want to, and other times they dip in because they have to.
Well, the Yankees' bullpen has really been outstanding, but you can't keep going the well too often. Espinoza will get the force at second on a good play, but that's all, as runners at first and third with one out.
Nice play by Espinoza. Sometimes the shortstop will go over in that hole in that first and second situation and get the easy force at third base. But watch what happens. Pat Kelly makes a dive, and so because he went after the ball, there's nobody at third. So Espinosa's only chance is to go to second, and he ended up making a good play.
Tough throw when you're going the other way and turn around and throw back. That's even more than across your body. I guess we'll have to call him Alvaro Espinoza. Espinoza.
He had a great line, though. Did you read what he said in the paper today?
No.
Madison Square Garden Network, which televises a lot of Yankee games, presented players with gifts because of their pregame and postgame shows. And one of the gifts that Espinosa selected out of tape players and whatever was a vacuum. And he said, well, I play shortstop. I'll take the vacuum.
Only appropriate. I like that. Well, you want to play shortstop. Joe Arcelak, two balls and no strikes. And Jeff Johnson trying to pitch out of trouble in the second. Fouled away. Joe Arcelak has become a very steady ball player. But one thing he has yet to do, and that's hit a home run against a left-handed pitcher. In his entire career, and he doesn't hit that many home runs, granted. He has only three this year, but he has never homered against a left-handed pitcher. Off the end of the bat.
Bad news for Coca-Cola.
Yeah. This is not one where you might get that 500.
One of the reasons you always try to put together a reason with that kind of a statement is that he waits a long time. He doesn't have a lot of power, but he'll take the right-hander deep occasionally, but he waits even longer against a left-hander. Most of his base hits against lefties go the other way.
Which is good policy. That's why he is a good hitter.
That's why he's averaged about 280 the last 3 years with Baltimore.
Strike three called. Orcelak, ordinarily known for having a good eye, disagrees a little bit with Darryl Cousins, the home plate umpire, but he's out of there, and a big out it is. The second out of the inning with runners at first and third.
Well, we mentioned that Johnson is not a strikeout pitcher, but he does have control. The target was put there by Matt Noakes, and Johnson put it right into the mitt. Now, it might have been an inch or two off the plate, but that's where the target was.
And nine times out of ten, you're going to get that call. So it's up to Dave Segee, hitting 259, two homers and 14 RBIs.
When we talked about the infield of the Orioles, we mentioned first base is a crowded position. And David Segee, a fine first baseman, probably the best defensive first baseman they have. Milligan, standing at third, is playing first this afternoon.
Foul behind home plate, 1-1.
And Segee falls into that category of a first baseman, I can certainly relate to this, without a lot of power. And so consequently, they're trying to get him some work in the outfield because he is a good line drive type hitter, but he doesn't have the power that a lot of teams require at first base.
And you say you know something about that because that's how you were somewhat regarded during your career. Although you were an outstanding hitter, Tommy, and that makes up for a lack of. That's inside the bag, and at least one run will score. Milligan comes home. Foyles goes to third. 1-0 Baltimore as the Orioles get a big two-out RBI base hit from Dave Segee.
And that stroke right there is exactly the way David Segee needs to swing. And he should stay that way. If you try to start becoming something you're not, then you'll quickly go back to Triple A. He hits the ball all over. He's a switch hitter. Keep it right there, and he'll have some success in the big leagues. Mattingly coming off, but ball hit so sharply, Gold Glove of Don Mattingly couldn't even get to it.
So that'll bring up Billy Ripken. Bill batting 226. With runners at first and third. Ball one. It's what teams like to do offensively when they get the chance. First and third.
Yeah, some of the cries you hear from the dugout. Players will say first and third them, or you'll see somebody hit a leadoff double. They'll tell the hitter that's walking up to the plate, trade places with him.
Yep. Babe Big high chopper up the middle. Sacks behind the bag to Espinoza in time to force Seguin and end the inning. But they did a little first and third and picked up a run on three hits here in the second. The O's lead the Yanks 1-0 as we go to the bottom of the second inning. And as you look at the standings in the American League's Eastern Division, the Yankees, Tommy, have really, at least lately, been able to at least keep pace with leading Toronto.
Well, that's right. The Yankees have won five straight. Blue Jays have won five straight. The Red Sox are on a three-game winning streak, and the Tigers have won two in a row. All those top four teams in a winning trend.
Getting interesting. Mel Hall with a sharp ground ball on the first pitch to Milligan. One out in the second. Let's go back to the studio for an update from Gary Miller.
Steve, the wind is blowing out at Wrigley. With Dunston aboard, Randy Tomlin facing Andre Dawson, and the Hawk gets into one. Takes it out to bleachers for his 13th home run of the year and a 2-0 lead in the first. But then in the top of the second, Maddox facing Barry Bonds, and Bonds answers. He goes left field, his 11th home run of the year. Makes it 2-1, but in our total for homers for America, that's a quick $10,000 for the Star-Spangled Banner Monument. Back to Yankee Stadium.
I like it. I like that cash register, wherever that thing is. Well, Kevin Mons also hitting the first pitch. Flies out to Seguin in right center field. And so far, Roy Smith has had what you might call the perfect inning. Two pitches, two out.
Then one thing is going to happen this afternoon. If Roy Smith keeps throwing that curveball, sooner or later, he'll make a mistake and get a little more in. Now, this is out over the plate. You can see where Hoyles is going to catch it. If he gets one of those middle of the plate or in, the Hall, the Mattingly, the Moss, the Noakes, add another $5,000.
There you go. It'll be Souvenir City. Two out and nobody on for Jesse Barfield, who's hitting just .231. But Jesse really is having a better year than that. He has 17 home runs and 48 RBIs as we near the All-Star break.
A lot of conversation going around the Yankee clubhouse this morning as to who might be their representative in this year's All-Star game. There are a few possibilities.
There are.
You're looking at one of them, Jesse Barfield, Don Mattingly, Matt Noakes,
and even Steve Sachs.
Steve Sachs, Scott Sanderson, they're winning his pitcher.
Fine tight. And it's 3-0. Well, who would you pick? I'll tell you who I'd pick if it were up to me, based on the all, not just the year he's having. We can get into some real discussion about all-star criteria if you want to. But just if you took everything into consideration. I'll tell you what, Jesse was trying to lose that one, and he lost it foul. He didn't miss it by much. Baltimore's starting pitchers have really struggled. Talk about the Yankees putting a lot of pressure on their bullpen. Baltimore's bullpen has had even more pressure and has not been up to the task, as has the Yankees. 3-2.
Well, they've had Ben McDonald on the disabled list a lot. However, he pitched extremely well after coming back 8 innings the other night against Detroit. No runs, no walks. 7 strikeouts, so they're happy to have him back in the rotation. Go on with Roy Smith, Ron Robinson, Jeff Ballard.
Popped up short center field. Bill Ripken going out, Mike Devereaux coming in, and Billy run off the play properly by Devereaux, who ends the inning. Tommy and I will tell you, our selections for the Yankees are representative to the All-Star team when we come back. I know you can't wait. There's Don Mattingly, and all things considered, this is the guy that I would pick because he's been away from the All-Star game for a while. It's the fans' game. This is a guy on the Yankees that they would want to see. He's hitting over .300. He's had a great career. But there are reasons, because of the way selections are made, that he's probably not the guy that's going to be picked. And I think the guy that you would pick has a better shot because of it.
And there's the back of the guy I might pick would be Matt Noakes. And a lot of it goes because of a 28-man roster. Does the American League need another catcher? Because Mark McGwire, who's not having a good year, was voted in by the fans. Now that lets loose another first baseman who might make the club. Wally Joyner has been outstanding.
Certainly deserving.
Year.
So Mattingly, who, when you look just at the Yankee roster, is a deserving guy to go in the overall scheme of things because of the way the voting by the fans has worked out to where deserving players are sometimes not selected and lesser deserving players are. There's not maybe room for Mattingly to be the Yankee representative. Devereaux with a ground ball to short. Espinoza with a backhand and a long throw for out number one. Seven in a row have been retired by Roy Smith.
There's that vacuum of Alvaro Espinoza. He made that look easy.
Pitching, Jeff Johnson is pitching. He's the one who's retired six in a row, not Johnson.
Johnson's on his way to seven in a row. He's at two right now.
Well, that's what happens when you're looking at the wrong side of the scorecard. It's a day game. Give me a break. Tim Hewlett, wish I had the hitter right. Tim Hewlett grounded to second his first time up.
The old all-star controversy happens every year.
And you can carry it over into the way in which the most valuable player voting, which is not done by the fans, is handled. Mattingly has a play, and there are two out here in the third inning. Let's go back to Gary Miller.
Steve, Budweiser takes you to Sky Dome. Twins and the Blue Jays. David West, the emergency starter, called in when Scott Erickson went down with an injury. Looks smooth. Devo White looks at strike three. The Twins have a 1-0 lead in a Junior Ortiz fielder's choice in the fifth.
Thank you, Gare. Well, here's Cal. Got a base hit and then was picked off first base to end the first inning. As great a year as he's having, entering the game leading the American League and hitting at 348, his road batting average, here we are near the All-Star break. His batting average on the road this year is over 400.
I guess one of the amazing things about the year Cal is having is that before the season started, when the Orioles acquired Glenn Davis, everybody said, oh, that'll really help Cal Ripken Jr. He'll have a good bat behind him, reminiscent of the Eddie Murray days. And that hasn't happened because of the injury to Glenn Davis. And he still hit in the 350s almost all year.
Look at that 392 average against left-handed pitching. Misses the fastball, however. Great location by Jeff Johnson.
You know, I kidded about this being like an off day for Ripken. The reason I said that is during the entire streak he's had going, he never misses infield practice. Some players, superstars, will, well, I won't take infield today. But Cal Ripken is out there all the time.
And among those who don't take it all the time are a lot of guys who have nothing near a streak going as far as consecutive games played. Well, that may be a Cal Ripken call right there. Certain players have a tendency to be given the benefit of the doubt.
A good pitch, though, by Jeff Johnson. You saw him prior to that go away right here on the next pitch. He tries to come inside. He put it where he wanted. If you miss, you want to miss off the plate in.
Ripken gets jammed and
came right back with the same one.
Yep, it worked this time as he grounds to Pat Kelly, and the inning is over. The Orioles go in order here in the third, but they still lead it 1-0.
ESPN Major League Baseball is brought to you by Miller High Life. By that man a Miller. By that fan a Miller. And by Ramada. Ramada, for the people who get it done.
Steve Zabriskie and Tommy Hutton with you from Yankee Stadium. A wonderful 4th of July to you all, and we certainly hope it is a state as well as a happy one for you and yours. Bottom of the order, and later tonight, of course, it continues with game 2 and 3 of our triple header on the 4th of July. We'll tell you more about it as the day goes along. Billy Ripken going up to take a hit away from Matt Noakes. One away.
So much is talked about with Cal Ripken. Here's a couple of guys. Billy and Cal, last year between them, only made 11 errors. There's some sure hands up the middle for the Orioles. That combination, by the way, 11 errors for a double play combo, the fewest ever in the history of the game.
Well, the Orioles have a very good defensive team overall. In spite of their record, they're second in the American League to the California Angels, who have the best fielding percentage. California's committed 39 errors and the Orioles 46. Alvaro Espinoza. Give Chris Berman something to work on.
Steve Berman Zabriskie.
No.
No.
Base hit. Espinoza going for two. He's out of there. Joe Orsulak with a good play in left field to throw out Espinoza two away.
Well, I tell you what, the move by Oates to put Orsulak in left and Segui in right paying off early. That slow curveball ripped that time by Espinoza. Watch how quickly Orsulak gets rid of the ball, like an infielder. Almost like a first baseman turning a double play. He doesn't really care how strong the throw is. He wants to get rid of it quickly and accurately, which he does, right on the money to Billy Ripken.
And that is a tougher play for a left-handed fielding left fielder.
That's probably the reason Espinoza tried to get into scoring position.
Not a bad play, incidentally, by Espinoza.
You can't
blame him at all. That's what he should do. But he's out of there with a single and thrown out trying to make it into a double. Pat Kelly lofts one to left field, and Orsulak will have a bit of an easier play to end the inning. Well, one hit now for the Yankees, but Roy Smith has still only faced the minimum through three.
50 years ago on the 4th of July, Joe DiMaggio had a holiday, still holding the longest hitting streak in baseball history at 45. The longest current streak, Brett Butler, whose Dodgers play the Padres in the back end of our tripleheader at 10 Eastern time. His is at 17 games. Mattingly is a game away from that. Let's go back to the 1991 Yanks.
Ah, yes. Thank you, Gary. The great history embodied by the Monument Park, which used to be part of the playing field here before the remodeling of Yankee Stadium back in the 70s, and now it's out there and been decorated with trees where the flagpole sits and all those monuments of those great Yankee players of the past. Randy Milligan singled and scored the only run of the game in the second inning as he led off. That's as he is doing now here in the fourth. One to nothing Orioles. Just inside, 2-1.
Funny, there are always statistics about just about everything. I was actually wondering this morning as I came to Yankee Stadium, who was the last Johnson to play for the Yankees? With Jeff Johnson pitching today. Sure enough, it was in the notes. Cliff Johnson.
Ah, he could swing that stick. Also played for Toronto, among other teams. Milligan with a high fly ball into left center field. Pat Kelly near the warning track, one away. I said Pat Kelly, it's Roberto Kelly, obviously. Well, tonight at 7 Eastern time, the Mets and the Expos. The Expos in Montreal, of course, it's always a big 4th of July at the Big O. Los Angeles at San Diego follows at 10 o'clock. Games 2 and 3 of our 4th of July triple header.
Today the Expo is trying to snap a 10-game losing streak. Brian Barnes against Wally Whitehurst.
And the Mets have been beating up on them. I don't think they've beaten New York this year. Maybe not.
Well, I'd say the Expos are 3-19 against the Mets and the Pirates. That's why the Expos are struggling right now. They haven't played well against the entire Eastern Division of the National League, especially those two top teams.
And that's who they've been playing lately. Leo Gomez had a single to center. Just a little tight, 2-1.
Leo Gomez has quietly taken over the third base job with Craig Worthington toiling at AAA right now, and Gomez has improved in his fielding. One of the reasons, as well as the bat, the Orioles have always liked a little better than Worthington.
On the ground to second. Sacks has it. Two away.
You know what, though, talking about Craig Worthington, Johnny Oates did say he is a Major League player. There's been a lot of interest in Worthington from other clubs looking for a third baseman.
Well, here's a guy that 2 years ago was on the all-rookie team in the American League as a third baseman.
He will be back. He's too good of a player to stay down there.
Chris Hoyle's reached on a fielder's choice in the second inning as Gomez was forced at second on the play.
You know, Steve, too, with expansion coming up, the two additional teams in the National League, a lot of borderline players that are still in their mid-20s, late-20s. Keep playing.
Yep, they may get their shot.
There'll be an opportunity there.
Two out, nobody on. Six in a row now, retired by Jeff Johnson. Right off one of the dogs. One ball, one strike. Royals with better success against left-handed pitchers, which is more the norm than it was Gomez.
Think about these young pitchers. Kamenicki won last night. Wade Taylor the night before. So here are the three rookies trying to make it three wins in a row. Yankees won five in a row as a team.
Well, of all the teams that have been down in baseball, a resurgence on the part of the Yankees to serious contention would probably do more positive for the game in general on a national level than maybe any other team, because there have been a lot of people who have in years past rooted for the Yankees. 2-2. And have sort of been soured on them for various reasons. A lot of people, quite frankly, didn't care for George Steinbrenner's approach and weren't going to root for the Yankees anymore. George is out of the picture to a great extent now, and the Yankees have changed their approach as to how they develop their players and bringing on the youth. High fly ball to left. Mel Hall flips the glasses down and waits. Seven in a row, retired by Jeff Johnson. The Orioles go in order in the fourth inning, but they still lead the Yankees 1-0. And greetings right back to you. Desert Storm troops being honored here. 10,000 military members and their families, the guests of the Yankees on this 4th of July. There's Mark Connor, the pitching coach for the Yankees, and very highly thought of.
Yeah, he is. And one of the theories he has with the young pitchers this year, the ones we've been talking about, Taylor, Kamenicki, and Johnson, is to not really clutter their minds a lot with scouting reports and how to pitch this hitter, how to pitch that hitter. He doesn't even go over the opposing team with these young pitchers. He wants them just to pitch the way they did before they came to the big league.
They have enough to worry about walking out and towing the mound at Yankee Stadium. Steve Sachs leads off the fourth inning for New York as Roy Smith has faced the minimum, giving up only one hit through the first three innings. Espinosa singling and then being thrown out trying to stretch it to two.
By the way, when we saw that shot of Mark Connor, the gentleman to his right was Pascual Perez. They hope to have him back, Mike Witt, Dave Island. So now all of a sudden you have maybe too many pitchers.
Well, I was talking to Stunt Merrill in his office this morning, and he said, I said the same thing. I said, you know, you got guys here depending on Witt. It's still kind of iffy, but if they all come back, you know, and these guys have proven themselves by then and they're still doing a good job. So you're going to have some decisions to make. He says, yeah, but those are the kind of problems the manager wants. He said, these others we've had, we're glad to be getting rid of. He said, he'd be happy to deal with that. Sacks popped out to the catcher, Chris Hoyle, in the first inning, and he grounds it here to Ripken. One away in the fourth, and let's go back to Gary Miller.
Steve, the rest of the East is playing catch-up to Toronto. The Twins trying to avoid the sweep. Kirby Puckett looking for his 100th hit of the season. Blast Jimmy Key to the warning track, but Devo White with the catch. And the Twins still have the 1-0 lead for David West in the sixth.
Thank you, sir. Roberto Kelly, the hitter. Fly deep to left in the first inning.
A lot of these hitters with the Yankees, the reason certainly the averages are up. They get a great mental lashing all the time from Frank Howard.
Ripken's just going to hold on to it, and appropriately, as he had no play, Kelly with such fine speed that Ripken said, I'll just corral this one and hold him to a single.
Looks like he did a little something to his ankle, too. It's nothing serious. He's all right, but looks like he caught the spike a little bit. Right at the last minute. See how he hops? I think he caught the spike of his ankle and also smartly decided, hey, I have no play with Roberto Kelly running. And that's the difference in a Cal Ripken and maybe a rookie shortstop with a gun. He'll go back and throw it away, and all of a sudden, Kelly's at second base.
Absolutely. So the Yankees have something going here in the fourth with Kelly at first and one out for Don Mattingly, who lined to center. Kelly leads the Yankees in stolen bases with 16 in 21 attempts.
See how Roy Smith performs right here. It's the first time he's had to pitch out of the stretch.
Leave it low. Ball one to Mattingly. Kelly's going. Hoyles with a good throw, got him. Chris Hoyles has just done a great job throwing out runners.
I'd say he's just a shade under 50%. He's thrown out 14 out of 29. That's the reason he's back behind the plate. Fair jump by Kelly, not a good one. But quick feet, quick release by Hoyles, and the throw on the money. Yeah, he's got some good tutoring working with Bob Melvin and Ernie Witt, veteran catchers. So it's been a good experience for Hoyles this year.
Mattingly with a high fly ball into right center. Calling for it is Mike Devereaux. And the inning is over. Still, Roy Smith has only faced the minimum through four. Two hits allowed, but a 1-0 lead for Baltimore. Welcome back to New York. 1-0 Baltimore leading the Yankees as we go to the top half of the fifth inning and the bottom third of the order for Baltimore. Joe Orsolak, Dave Segee, and Bill Ripken. And Roberto Kelly needed something, so he is a little late returning to center field.
Well, believe it or not, when you make that hard head first slide, sometimes you break the belt buckle. I'm going to guess he went in and had a chain belt. He
Orsolak
went in to get a belt.
Yeah.
It's a day game. Good heavens. How terrible. Joe Orsolak, who struck out in the second inning, lofts one to Kelly, who gets out there just in time to make the play. One away.
One thing the Yankees have in Roberto Kelly, and he's 26, he'll be 27 just after the season, but you're looking at an outfielder who's settled in to play center field for a number of years. They don't have to worry about their center field position for the next five to eight years.
The Yankees would certainly hope that would be the case. Dave Segee with a single to drive in the only run of the game in the second inning. A two-out base hit with runners at first and third that scored Milligan.
You talk about a huge gap. Segee not a full hitter. Kelly shading him to right center. Hall straight away in left field. He could drive all kinds of trucks through left center.
Ground ball through the hole into left field. And Dave Segee is two for two. He's the first with one out. Baseball action not only continues today and Friday night, but Sunday night as usual here on ESPN. It'll be the Rhino and the Wizard. Of course, the famous children's book. Sandberg and Smith, and a great rivalry. The Cubs and the Cardinals over the years have, because of the proximity of those two teams, have really had great rivalries. And Ryan Sandberg's supposed to be back in the lineup for Sunday night's game. 8 o'clock, right here on ESPN. John Miller and Joe Morgan will be there to bring it to you.
Hey, plus those two will be teaming up on Tuesday night in the All-Star game for the National League up the middle. Rhino and the Wizard.
That's right. That could be a story. Title of a story, The Rhino and the Wizard. But then I'm weird.
Watch, McCarver will probably steal that Tuesday night.
No, he'll write the book. There's the proud papa, Cal Sr.
Hey, it was funny. I'm talking to Cal Sr. on the bench before the game. I said, what you guys as a family used to do on July 4th? Oh, he said, we were always at a ballpark.
This is it.
This is our July 4th picnic. Somewhere at a ballpark.
And Bill takes ball two.
Billy starting to come up a little bit. He was, trivia question, he was the leading hitter on the Orioles last year, average-wise. Hit 291, but he got off to a real slow start. Recently, though, over the last month and a half, he's been around that 270 mark, but he's still in the 220s now, and he'll pick it up the second half.
Fastball in the hole. Espinoza gets the force. No, not sharply hit enough to get the double play. Not hit sharply enough. Another good play by Espinoza.
That's the second time we've seen Espinoza go deep into that hole and then throw across his body. I'm surprised Sachs even made a throw, but he got off a strong throw and turned out to be a fairly close play. See how the second baseman, you can go inside the bag, you can step back. That time Sachs made the step toward left field. He got a good feed from Espinoza.
So Ripken at first with two out, and the top of the order, Mike Devereaux, as Ripken draws a throw. Really going to the stubble look. And there's Johnny Oates. A tad low. Devereaux, who's 0 for 2. Mike is grounded to third and grounded to short.
Devereaux, one of those guys, we talked about him earlier, good line drive hitter, but he has surprising power, sneaky power. Once in a while, he'll drive one, has 9 home runs.
Foul back into the screen, 2-1, or 1-1.
He's very capable, staying healthy and playing a lot, to have a season where he could hit 20 home runs. But you don't think of him as a home run hitter.
No, and that would be a big plus, obviously, for any leadoff hitter to hit 20 home runs. That's one thing that makes Ricky Henderson so terrific as a leadoff hitter, is that extra dimension of power to go along with the speed and average. Tried to turn one over and catch the outside corner, but he missed. 2-1.
Interesting, too, a little connection with Devereaux up there facing Johnson. He was acquired from the Dodgers from Mike Morgan. Mike Morgan pitching tonight, going after win number 10 in the third and final game of our triple header. Morgan goes against Mr. Harris, Greg Harris of the Padres.
Another foul ball, 2-2. Devereaux likes those left-handers, but he's 0 for 2 against Jeff Johnson so far. Souvenir time. Not the most coveted, though. The most coveted is one of those foul balls or a home run in particular, if it's by the home team anyway. Ripped foul outside third.
Cal Sr. showing why his two sons have such great fielding records. See the quick footwork? Danced out of the way of that hard shot hit by Devereaux.
It's in the gene.
That's right.
Quick feet. Two and two with two out. And Billy Ripken at first. The Orioles leading 1-0 in the top of the fifth. Devereaux just keeps fouling them off. Did you have a family tradition on the fourth when you were growing up in California.
Been in baseball 27 years. I've been in a ballpark like the Ripkins. What do you mean?
I mean when you were a kid. I mean your dad works.
I was playing somewhere in the summer. I was playing Little League or something.
Yeah. Usually,
our tradition was
some baseball tournament.
Baseball.
That's right. There's some baseball tournament going on somewhere. Well, all the Yankee fans thought it was a strike, but it's 3-2.
And no complaints. I've seen some great fireworks displays at different ballparks. There's Mark Connor. That's his opinion of that call by Darryl Cousins. A big sigh and throw the head back.
Ball four. So, as so often, when the pitcher does not get the call, he winds up walking the hitter, and let's go to Gary Miller again.
Steve, some intrigue at Wrigley Field. Andre Dawson aboard having walked after his earlier home run. George Bell hits a bullet to the wall. Bonds gives chase, and Dawson's going to try and score from first. Now, he had a pitch that was high and tight when they walked him. Didn't like it, so he takes it out on Don Slott. If he'd have slid, he'd have been safe in a two-all game. That could prove costly.
We've seen a little bit of that going on recently. That's not the first time this year that has happened. This little, a purpose collision, shall we say?
A purpose slide, yeah. Or non-slide in that case. Well, that's tough with Dawson, too. You wonder about those knees, mm-hmm. giving him trouble over the years. But I know the Hawk doesn't take lightly being thrown at.
No. Here's Mark Connor coming out to talk now to Jeff Johnson. Try to settle him down a little bit. Well, the All-Star break is coming up, and the All-Star game's on Tuesday, but we have All-Star Monday for you. The All-Star salute at 8 o'clock Eastern Time, live from Sky Dome in Toronto. Tommy Hutton will be among those who will be there. The Upper Deck Old-Timers game. See some of the great players, All-Stars of the past at 9:30. Major League Baseball Magazine at 10:30. And Baseball Tonight, of course, full and complete coverage of the following day's All-Star activities, previewing the whole schlemiel.
Yeah,
what is a schlemiel, anyway?
Well, it's the legends of the game.
Oh, thank you. I always wondered what a schlemiel
is. I'm looking forward to that. There are going to be some great names participating in that Upper Deck Legends of the Game.
I had the honor of doing that game last year. Buffalo. It was a lot of fun.
Barry Thorne, Dave Campbell, and I will be on hand.
Is that Madonna in disguise? Oakland's not playing. I guess she wouldn't be here. Tim Hewlett fouls another one off. 2-2. Eric Plunk starting to warm up now as Mark Connor went out and not only tried to settle down Jeff Johnson after the two-out walk, but bought a couple of extra minutes for Plunk to start throwing. First and second with two out. A 2-2 count to Hewlett. And the fastball gets him. Jeff Johnson comes back to end the inning. One hit, one walk, two left in the fifth. Baltimore still leads it, though, 1-0.
ESPN Major League Baseball is brought to you by Old Milwaukee and Old Milwaukee Light. It doesn't get any better than this. And by Tartar Control Aqua Fresh, the fresh way to fight cavities, plaque, and tartar.
Happy birthday, America. Ballparks all over the country, all over North America. As a matter of fact, there's a couple of games in Canada today and tonight. We'll be full of folks enjoying the national pastime. Mel Hall leading off for the Yankees in the fifth, Baltimore leading by one. And the big curveball, and Mel Hall jacks it out of here. Game is tied, and Tommy, you called it. That curveball eminently hittable. Mel Hall obviously looking for it.
Well, I'm not sure what inning it was I was talking about, either the first or the second, but I mentioned the four left-handers, Hall, Mott, Mattingly, and Oakes. If they saw that big curveball, and if it had middle of the plate, one of these guys is going to go deep. And that's exactly the pitch Mel got. It was up a little bit, and it had too much of the plate. Not too much for Mel Hall's liking. Too much for Roy Smith.
Yeah, there you go. For Hall, his 12th home run of the year, his 43rd RBI, it ties the game at one in the bottom of the fifth inning. And it's the 84th home run for the Yankees, who have become the Bronx Bombers, so to speak, once again.
And you can't ease up. A couple of times recently, the Yankees have had back-to-back shots. Moss and Barfield did it most recently.
Well, Kevin Moss certainly capable. He has 14 home runs and 34 RBIs. He flied out to right field his first time up.
I'll tell you what, the Moss-Barfield back-to-back not too long ago, both of them reached the upper deck. Dude, a lot of yardage in those, too.
Right. Yeah, it's a short porch right down the line, but after that, it's a poke. Moss rips it into the corner. Fair ball. He's going to be held to a single, however, as Segee played it perfectly, and Kevin does not run that well. There's a tidal wave going on, a one-man tidal wave.
Again, the slow breaking ball, and Roy Smith can just be happy that Moss didn't get it in the air. Just fair. And a nice play by Segee. Even though he doesn't have the strong throwing arm, it's just an example of what an outfielder can do if he doesn't have a great arm. If he's average with the arm, if he gets to the ball quickly, releases in a hurry, and he got it in quick enough, and Moss, with his average speed, couldn't go to second base.
That's what stops runners, is getting to the ball and getting it in. Jesse Barfield flying to short center field, and he takes ball one.
You're also seeing right here the Yankees now, second time around, getting a look at that slow curveball. So they're seeing it a little better. They're waiting on it. And Roy Smith is making some mistakes with it.
And that brings Al Jackson, the pitching coach for the Orioles, out to the mound.
Well, it's got to be frustrating for little Al, doesn't it?
I'll tell you what. Al Jackson is so good at working with young pitchers and teaching. He has relished to some degree the role that he's had here. But the frustration of not having some of the pitchers that he thought he was going to be working with, and therefore putting extra pressure on those young guys, has made his job a little more difficult.
Day of one he had early in the year that they thought was going to be a beauty was Jose Mesa, and he's been sent back to AAA.
Nobody out. A run in on the leadoff homer by Hall. And Barfield takes ball two.
Roy Smith, one of those guys in his career with other organizations, mostly in the big leagues with Minnesota, he always pitched well against Baltimore. He was 4-0 lifetime against Baltimore. So when he was released by the Twins, Roland Heeman, the general manager of the Orioles, said, hey, let's get this guy.
That fastball just tailed off the plate, ball three.
It's funny how that works.
Yeah, it is amazing.
You see it all the time.
And even though trade for a guy who's eaten him up in some respect, offensively or as a pitcher, even if he does nothing against the rest of the league, that team thinks he's a world beater. Jesse asking for time. Yankees with their 84th home run here in this inning as Mel Hall led off with that shot to right, and so they are temporarily at least tied with the Cubs, second in baseball for most home runs. Down low, ball four.
Cubs, though, got one from Andre Dawson. We saw that earlier.
That's
Darren
right.
Miller talking about it.
So they have 85.
They're trying to stay ahead.
Still nobody out. Now runners at first and second. First walk issued by Roy Smith. And Al Jackson on the phone to the bullpen to see how it's going.
The thing that Johnny Oates knows about Roy Smith is that He is not the type of pitcher who is going to give you the 8, 7, 8, 9 innings. And so when he starts to falter in the middle of the game, you have to have somebody ready to bring in quickly because you don't want the game to get out of hand. Todd Froworth is warming up for the Orioles right now. He should be ready. He's been throwing for a while.
And when you throw like that, all you have to do is throw a couple and you're warmed up.
The only problem, he's a right-handed separator, and the Yankees still loaded with the lefties.
Yep. One more left-handed hitter, Matt Noakes. He lined out the second. Ground ball foul outside first. And Greg Nettles still with the outstanding hands makes the play.
It doesn't matter what side of the diamond Nettles is on.
Matt Noakes is asking to have the second base umpire, Rick Reed, reposition himself because apparently the ball, when it leaves the hand of Roy Smith, is in the uniform of Rick Reed. So Reed has moved over. And Noakes hits a high fly ball to fairly deep center field. Moss is tagging up at second, but he's not going anywhere. And the throw comes into second by Devereaux. He just wanted to draw a throw, and
yeah,
he did.
It was a good thought, though, by Devereaux. He knew that Moss was not going to third. And so he knew he was bluffing. So his thought was to try to sneak one behind him. You wouldn't want to throw behind a speedy runner. He may take off and get to third base. That's a good play by Devereaux.
There's Buck Showalter, the third base coach for the Yankees. Hey, you know, if a guy does make a serious bluff, he could lose his footing, fall down, try to scramble back, and you've got him. Heads up play by Devereaux.
Talking about the umpire, second base, Rick Reed moving background. Some umpires give you better background.
Yeah, that's true.
Eric Gregg, Ken Kaiser.
John McJerry.
You know, if they're at second, they give you a nice background.
Yeah. I can handle that well, actually. But I'm not an umpire. Espinoza had a base hit.
Nice play there by Chris Hoyle.
Outstanding play.
That's the one that isn't the short hop. That's the one bouncing out in front of the plate where he just gets down, sacrifices his body and says, hit me, ball, but stay out in front of the plate, right, so the runners can't advance.
Do anything to block it and keep it in front of you. The runner's going, and Espinoza, trying to protect him, reaches out and fouls it off.
Well, I'll tell you, the ultimate in the hit and run is surprise, and that was certainly a surprise with the two base runners, Kevin Moss, Jesse Barfield. The only part of that play that wasn't a surprise is that Espinoza makes pretty good contact. He's a pretty good hit and run man. And you also, I'm going to even go further, say in the American League, don't see the hit and run as much with runners at first and second.
No, and it's my favorite hit and run play. I love it with runners at first and second. And you don't see it in
play.
The American League very much. I think it's a great play. I think it does more to get things going, move the infielders around than almost anything else you can do. High fly ball to left. Orsulak over into left center. Two away, and the runners go back.
But give some credit to Stump Merrill. He realized with the situation at hand, he had the bottom of the order up there. Espinoza, Pat Kelly coming up. And again, at Yankee Stadium, where you expect the long ball, it was a surprise, but a good play.
I don't think it's done enough in either league. And that's my personal opinion, because I think it's a good play.
Well, I came up farm and school in the Dodgers organization. They do it a lot.
Yeah, a lot. All the time. They probably don't even do it as much as they used to either. Pat Kelly flied out to left to end the third inning. Up here with two out and two on, and another one bounced up there by Roy Smith. Yankees have tied it here in the fifth inning on Mel Hall's leadoff home run to right. Kevin Moss followed with a single. Jesse Barfield walked. And they are still at second and first, respectively, now with two out. All back.
And a hanger. Pat Kelly had a nice swing. I'd say everybody you talk to in the Yankees organization about Pat Kelly has nothing but good things to say about him. And here he is learning a new position at the major league level, trying to learn that position and also adjust to major league pitching.
What was it Greg Nettles said to us the last time we were here? He said he is a great second baseman. He will be a good, very good third baseman. He's almost a natural second baseman. There's that big bender, but it's too high. 2-1.
Which we also enjoyed the story that Nettles told us, the fact that when he came up, he too was a second baseman,
right.
Was converted to a third baseman because the Twins had a guy named Rod Carew at the time.
There's that big breaking ball again. Check swing foul. He didn't want to, but it's 2-2. Smith now has thrown 52 pitches. That's not an inordinate number at this point in the ball game. He's in the fifth. But his strikeout and ball ratio could be a little stronger. Amazingly, he's only walked one batter, and that was Barfield here in the fifth. This is the first time he's ever had any real adversity to contend with. Fastball got him. The Yankees get one to tie it on the leadoff home run, but leave two aboard. It's 1-1 after five. Paul in left field, who tied the game, and boy, what a wonderful job he did of waiting for this ball.
Well, you look for that pitch that you can pull, the slow curve. They've seen it all afternoon. You count to 10, and then you lay back on it. Mel Hall, as I've mentioned before, with the other left-handers in the lineup for the Yankees, perfect stance and stroke here for Yankee Stadium. You want to pull it, you only have to hit it about 340 to get it out down the line. 314 if you go right down the line.
A lot of ballparks, 340 into any semblance of the position is a fly ball short of the warning track. Cal Ripken, 1-for-2, single to left in the first, grounded to third to end the third inning. And he takes ball one. It's only 318 down the right field line, so if you pull it as a right-handed hitter down there, you've got an easy shot, but then it is expansive in left and left center. 399 in the power alley. And I don't think that 408 is accurate. Never have thought so. 385 in right center, and then it starts to curve in sharply to 314 down the right field line. Barfield coming on and retires Cal Ripken. One away in the sixth. Let's go back to Gary Miller.
Steve, at Wrigley Field, a two-all game in the fifth with a man aboard. Randy Tomlin faces Mark Brace in the wheelhouse. Strokes a line shot just into the basket for his fifth home run to give the Cubs a 4-2 lead. In our Home Runs for America, that's three at Wrigley, and yours by Mel Hall gives us $20,000 towards the Star-Spangled Banner Monument.
Thank you very much, Gary, and thank you very much, Coca-Cola and Major League Baseball. 20 grand already. And most of the games yet to come tonight.
Gary making change with all this?
I like cash register. I like that. He's ringing them up.
You talk about the expansiveness in left center, though. In the old Yankee Stadium used to be 457
oh.
Left center, 461 center field.
Death for right-handed pull hitters. And yet, there's been some pretty good ones played here.
Had some success.
That used to be 457.
Well, the wall used to be
the monument
behind
play.
Where the monuments are. That tree wasn't there.
And that 408, as you said, might be longer. Maybe it is still 461. They just changed the number.
I never can believe it. I can't see how it could be 399 in left center, just barely left center, and then 408 straight away center. Looks like a mile out.
I'll tell you the shot that I'll always remember, that shot that Reggie hit the World Series. The third home run, the knuckleball he hit off Charlie Huff. Straight away center field into those bleacher seats that are blacked out now.
Randy Milligan lofts one to right field that Barfield handles for out number two.
Today we saw the trip to the mound that Mark Connor had, settling Johnson down. Al Jackson has done it with his pitcher, but you have to really like the way this 24-year-old, who was pitching in Fort Lauderdale last year at this time, the way he's reacted.
And again, you really do have to give a lot of credit to the pitching coaches. Mark Connor there with Big Frank Howard and Al Jackson of the Orioles for the work they've done with each of their young staff.
Well, I heard a lot of nice things said about Mark. Had an opportunity to be around him too But Tommy John, in an interview just recently, had some great things to say about Mark Connor, how he helped him in the final stages of TJ's career here with the Yankees.
And that's a great compliment from a guy who you wouldn't think would need a whole lot of help and has seen a lot of pitching coaches over the years. Leo Gomez with a fly ball to center. Roberto Kelly hardly has to move. And on three lazy fly balls, an easy 1-2-3 inning for Jeff Johnson here in the sixth. A 1-1 tie here at Yankee Stadium. In the sun here at Yankee Stadium today on a beautiful 4th of July. 1-1 tie going to the bottom of the sixth. And I guess it's good weather for almost anything, right? Baseball, golf, whatever you want to do. What a great face on that little pumpkin head.
That's the way to celebrate.
That's right. And here we are, missing our kids. Top of the order, Steve Sachs to lead off the sixth inning for the Yankees. Sachs 0-for-2 is popped out and grounded out. And he gets a fastball, but fouls it out of play down the right field line.
I kind of relate the way Sachs has turned things on with the situation between Steve Sachs and Pat Kelly when they tried to put Sachs at third base. Ever since that time, that weak experiment, W-E-E-K.
Yeah, it was W-E-A-K also.
And as soon as Sachs went back to second base, that's when he started hitting. He's played 35 straight games there, and he's hit over 354. So all of a sudden, he got relaxed and put that out of his mind. He's been a better hitter.
I think that's the case with most guys. They want to have a set position, a set spot in the batting order, if possible. And most players will say to the manager, just tell me what you expect of me. What's my role? Fine, that's it. I'll go do my job.
Think about Steve Sachs, though. He's such a team player. He did it. He didn't complain.
That's
he said,
right.
Oh, I'm not going over there. He did it.
He knew that if it was better for the team, it would be worth doing. Quickly, they found out it wasn't better for the team or for him.
Deep down, he knew after a couple of throws, he'd be back in second.
Yeah, well, if you remember back in Steve Sachs' career, he used to not be able to get it to first from second base. So now they want him to do it from third. This is deep, deep to left. Tater time.
About if you pull the ball at Yankee Stadium, be it left field or right field, even if you have minimal power, Steve Sachs can hit one out. Most he's ever hit in a season is six.
And that was his fifth of the year, and as you said, Tommy, the second in 2 days. It also extends his hitting streak to 10 games, over which he's hit over 400. So Sachs gives the Yankees the lead, 2-1. Scored both their runs on home run.
Now Johnny Oates gets a lefty ready. Kevin Hickey.
This one bounced up there. There are certain things that managers and pitching coaches look for, and one of those is when a pitcher starts to get his pitches up in the strike zone, it usually denotes he's losing a little. He's getting a little tired. Roberto Kelly takes low, 2-1. Kelly 1-for-2.
Roy Smith knew when he got the pitch up. Sachs hit it out. He's telling himself, guys like Mattingly, Moss, okay. Keep Sachs no.
Cal Ripken throws out Kelly one away.
The Yankees have really been amazing this year as far as coming from behind. At 18 come from behind wins. Had a tremendous series against Milwaukee where they won a couple of games in a row and scored a ton of runs late in the ballgame.
And that really builds that psychological aspect of a game positively. Get that team confidence. Don Mattingly 0-for-2 has lined to center and flied to center. Senior Classic, 4 o'clock Eastern Time tomorrow here on ESPN. Coverage begins. Just one more thing to enjoy on your holiday weekend. Fastball lofted into right center field. Devereaux has a bead on it. Two away.
Mattingly 0 for 3 trying to extend that hitting streak. He's at 16 right now.
There's Mel Hall, who gets a good hand for his game-tying home run leading off last inning. Fifth inning, his 12th of the year.
Talking about dramatics, Mel Hall already in half the season has had some dramatic home runs.
You know, being around, you mentioned Frank Howard, the hitting instructor of the Yankees, and being around Hondo, his enthusiasm is pretty infectious. And he is so strong in reinforcing the positive attitude that as a hitter, you've got to really appreciate that, to work with a guy like that, because so much of hitting is having a positive mental attitude when you go up there.
Yeah, there are other hitting instructors that might be a little more analytical and work with the mechanics more, but Big Frank likes to get that mental attitude in the right direction and likes to get the thinking in the right direction with the hitter. What to look for, 2-1, 2-0, 3-1, that type of thing.
What to be thinking about while you're up there. Give yourself more of a chance. It's hard enough. Milligan fooled. A good pitch, 2-2. Milligan.
Mel Hall. Turn that scorecard over.
I got the scorecard over. I don't even know what I'm thinking of.
See, that was the difference. The home run that Hall hit in the fifth inning, the curveball was up a little bit, had more of the plate. That ball stayed outside, had better break to it.
This one hit into right center. A long run for Segui. Did he make the catch? Yes, he did. David Segui with a diving stab to take a base hit away from Mel Hall and end the inning. But the Yankees take a one-run lead after trailing by one just two innings ago. Sacks with the home run.
I think he hurt his shoulder.
Welcome back to Yankee Stadium, where the Yankees have used some of that newfound power to take the lead after trailing 1-0. Steve Zabriskie and Tommy Hutton with you on this 4th of July. Game one of a triple header, remember, with two more games tonight. And Jeff Johnson, now pitching well, has to keep it close. And now he's got the one-run lead.
Well, he's keeping it close, but the other thing the Yankees stump Merrill and Mark Connor know is that they've had such success from their bullpen that if Johnson happens to falter, they can dip into a bullpen that's been very good for the Yankees this year.
They put a lot of pressure on it because of not having enough quality starts. That's one thing Stump Merrill was talking to me about this morning. If he could go to a department store and off the rack pick the things he needed for a ball club, he'd say, give me a dozen quality starts, quick.
Well, the guy who's given him the most quality starts, 9-3, is Scott Sanderson, the veteran of the staff.
But I guess with young pitchers, you know, getting the experience in the big leagues, you can't expect them to have an abundance of quality starts right off the bat. But boy, the bullpen has picked up the slack. So the Yankees are in a pretty good position owing to that now that they have the lead. Chris Hoyles drives it deep to right. And it's gone. Just over the wall. Hoyles leading off the seventh inning, reties the game. It's 2-2.
And I guess if Phil Rizzuto were here, he'd say, Hoily cow. Well, that shows you what you can do at Yankee Stadium. He didn't hit that ball that well, but because it was to right field and in that area, just before you get to those deep bleachers in right center, we talked about 330, 340 out there. You get it up in the air, no chance for Jesse.
Just into the glove of a young fan who threw it back onto the field, and now Orsulak, trying to bunt his way on, pushes it foul. Here's Hoyles homer again the other way.
They give Hoyles credit for not trying to pull the pitch. If you try to pull Jeff Johnson the way he's pitched this afternoon, you're going to hit ground balls to the left side if you're a right-handed hitter.
And a la the Chicago fans in Wrigley Field, hey, we don't want this ball. This was hit by the opposition. He pegged it pretty good. It rolled back to the infield.
Well, the test of a true fan, though, is if a home run from the opposition is hit and it's some sort of a historical home run.
Yeah.
Do they keep it or do they throw it back?
Right. Derek Plunk, who was up earlier, throwing again for the Yankees.
And Plunk, really the only unsuccessful bullpen guy for the Yankees this year.
Mattingly spears the line drive by Joe Orsolat. One away in the seventh. And let's go back to the studio and hear.
Ah, that sound. And you know what it means. Along with Hoyle's home run, Keith Jones of Johnson City in the minors is homered. We now have seven on the day. $35,000 by Coca-Cola for a Star-Spangled Banner monument in the nation's capital. Back to Yankee Stadium.
Thanks, Gary. Who's covering that game in Johnson City? That's what I want to know. They've got guys out at all these ballparks calling ESPN. Hitting the first pitch is Dave Segee and grounding to the third baseman, Pat Kelly, for out number two.
I'm surprised that Segee even hit. He's kind of holding that left shoulder tenderly. He has a wrap on his wrist. When he made that diving catch to end last inning, it really appeared that he jammed his shoulder. But he wants to stay in the lineup.
He is the son of former major leaguer Diego Segee. So that'll bring up Bill Ripken with two out and nobody on, but the game retied on Chris Hoyle's leadoff homer. A drive to right field. Barfield had him play very well. Shallow and near the line, so it's a fairly easy play on a hard hit ball for out number three. One run and one hit on the home run, and we're tied at two in the middle of the seventh. And the seventh, Kevin Moss is going to lead it off. Before the game, Tommy Hutton talked to the hitting instructor of the Yankees, Frank Howard, about Kevin's problem driving in runs.
I think he might conceivably get a little more aggressive or widen his strike zone with runners just from him. But for the time being, I wouldn't make a big issue of it. He's going to knock in 65, 75, 80 runs. He's 26 years old. Most hitters don't really come into their prime until they're 28, 30, 32, 33 years old. And I would think in time this young man has an excellent chance of driving in 100-plus runs for the New York Yankees.
Kevin Moss has 34 RBIs at this point in the season to go with his 14 homers. And he takes ball one.
Yeah, I think Hondo just was right on the money with that. Sometimes you put too much emphasis on that with a young hitter. All right, 11 of his last 12 home runs are solo shots. Hey, he's hit home runs, though. They'll come as he matures as a hitter.
Well, you know, one of the problems, there's Frank right there, one of the problems that you have as a young player who has early success, as Kevin Moss has had, all of a sudden even more is expected of you now, and you heap extra pressure on yourself, not of really of your own making, because you've done a good job. This one's going to drop in for a base hit into right center. His second hit of the game.
Two different types of hits. The first one in the fifth, a line shot that was played nicely by Segee in right field. This one looped into right field. Now, Stump Merrill's talking with Moss. He wants to know how his knee feels. He does a lot of stretching. I was in the clubhouse, and he was, before he completely dressed, he was down in for stretching, trying to get loose for this day game. And Stump Merrill just checking to see how his wheels feel right now.
Well, he is the go-ahead run here in the seventh inning of a 2-2 tie. And he's aboard with nobody out for Jesse Barfield, who is flying to shallow center and walked. Roy Smith has gone all the way for the Orioles. Ground ball to third, could be two. Bill Ripken makes a nice save, and they get Barfield. A heck of a job by Ripken to turn it under difficult circumstances.
Oh, that was tremendous. Nice play by Gomez. He had a little tricky hop, but then his throw onto Billy Ripken wasn't a good one. Gomez stays with it. His throw takes Ripken toward the sliding Moss, but Billy Ripken stayed right with it and unleashed a good throw. And then had to get out of the way. So it's not just Cal that can turn things out at the second base spot.
Fine job by Billy to at least momentarily diminish the Yankees' threat, and that big curveball drops right in there to Matt Noakes, strike one.
That's the time as a hitter, Noakes is saying, I should have looked for it then. Didn't think he'd throw it to me on the first pitch.
Well, Barfield back in the, or Mel Hall it was, back in the fifth inning, certainly was looking for it on the first pitch, and he hit it out. Noakes is lined to second and flying to center. One ball, one strike.
Roy Smith has stayed right in this one, though. He's had a couple of times where he struggled, giving up the two home runs.
A little bit high, 2-1.
Guy was kind of bounced around, signed by the Phillies organization back in 79. Went to Cleveland, the other players, and John Denny deal, 82. And then on to Minnesota.
Way outside, 3-1. Given up two runs on five hits. He has struck out one and walked one. Of course, allowed two solo home runs for those two runs. Matt Noakes chasing a bad pitch. That is not the kind of swing you want to have on a 3-1 count.
No, and you almost have to wonder if he probably just told himself, I'm going to get that curveball this pitch. Looked for it, but it was so bad he couldn't stay away from it.
Three and two, two out and nobody on.
He'd really have him if he could spot a good high fastball. There it is.
He tried, but he missed. Noakes aboard on the walk with two out, the second walk issued by Roy Smith.
Now we've had both pitchers, though, really be on their game with the controls and strikeouts. We talked about Johnson. He's only struck out two, walked one. Roy Smith, only one strikeout, but that's just his second walk.
Alvaro Espinoza.
See that? ESP, take that
eye out of there. ESPN. I think Berman ought to pick up on that.
Espinoza.
One for two as he swings and misses. Bill Rifkin, ball just not carrying to right field, as they would say. One hit, but nobody left here in the seventh inning as a fine double play erased the threat, and it's still a 2-2 tie after seven.
ESPN Major League Baseball is brought to you by Natural Light from Anheuser-Busch, where there's good food and good times, it's only natural. By Chevy Trucks, more people are winning with the heartbeat of America. By John Deere Lawn Care Dealers, stop by your local dealer to see why nothing runs like a deer. And by Coca-Cola Classic, you can't beat the real thing.
Jeff Johnson is through for the day. And it's been a good day, even though he will leave with a no decision in a 2-2 tie, seven innings. And the two runs allowed, but only one walk, two strikeouts. And Eric Kerr-Plunk is on.
You look at the earned run average of Plunk, who has a good fastball and curveball, and it looks high, but he has improved. Go back to May 22nd. Since that time, his earned run average has been 1.64. So he's brought it down from in the nine to where it is now. So even though earned run average is up compared to the rest of the bullpen the Yankees have, he has improved. And they really have a lot of different looks that they can give hitters. Plunk, Hatteray, Steve Howe, John Havian, Lee Guterman. They can throw different types of pitchers at you out of the bullpen.
And the Yankees will do that sometimes with situational changes. That one so high that it went right off the top of Matt Noakes' glove and may have even caught the mask of Darryl Cousins.
Yeah, right now Cousins not real happy with Matt Noakes.
Point.
Then you have to catch that ball, Matt.
Mix in a catch once in a while, please. That's when they really get bonked, too, is when you don't expect it. You expect the catcher to catch the ball. You're not really braced to be hit in the head. Devereaux in this game is 0 for 2, plus a walk. In the fifth inning, he's grounded out his other two times up. Top of the order, Devereaux, Hewlett, and Cal Ripken. 1-1.
Yeah, it's sure been a tough goal for Jeff Johnson, who's plunked replacing. He's 1-3 coming into this game. He'll get a no decision. He'll stay 1-3. Scott Merrill was saying he's matched up against some of the toughest pitchers. And today, not necessarily the type you could consider tough in Roy Smith, but he pitched like a tough pitcher today.
Espinoza with another good play. One out here in the eighth inning. Let's go back to Gary in the studio.
Steve Budweiser, the king of beers, takes you to Sky Dome where Rick Aguilera is trying to finish up a shutout of the Jays. Rob Ducey flies out, and so David West's first appearance of the season following elbow problems, a combined three-hit shutout with Bedrosian and Aguilera, who picked up his 21st save. They're back in first place. Let's go back to Yankee Stadium.
Thank you, Gary. Minnesota able to salvage one game of that series to move back in first in the Western Division of the American League. Here we are tied at two with one out in the eighth inning, and Sam Horn is going to pinch hit for Tim Hewlett.
One thing you get when you bring in a right-hander that Johnny Oates can pull off some lefties, but then to counter, that's why Stump Merrill has Greg Catterae warming up.
Sam Horn, who a lot of people think his first name is actually Big, because that's how he's referred to almost every time, Big Sam Horn. Mark Connor on the phone to the bullpen. Horn hitting 238 with 12 homers and 30 RBIs. It's a ball one.
Reason Catterae is taking his time right now, once he realized he wasn't going to be used to pitch against Horn, he knows he won't be called on to face Ripken or Milligan. The right hand is coming up next, who will not be pinch hit for.
So now he can save it a little bit. Horn didn't really save anything with that swing as he took a big rip, 1-1. Cal Ripken on deck. Baltimore led 1-0, scoring in the second inning. The Yankees tied it in the fifth, took a 2-1 lead in the sixth. Baltimore tied it with a home run in the seventh. And Plunk with some good high heat, and it's 2-2 to Sam Horn.
Well, if Plunk gets that fastball up in that zone, because it's 90 miles an hour, it'll be hard to catch up to. However, Sam Horn can catch up to it.
Done an excellent job off the bench. Not this time, however. Eric Plunk strikes him out. Two out in the eighth.
This one clocked at 91 miles an hour and also in a good spot. Saw the one before was up. This one right out in the outside corner and down around the knee, so a good spot for Eric Plunk. And when he has control, that's always the problem with him. Not control with the fastball and curveball, then he has trouble. He throws it there, he'll be successful.
So two out, nobody on for Cal Ripken, who is 1-for-3. Single to left back in the first inning. Barfield, and the inning is over. Eric Plunk retires the Orioles in order in the eighth, and we are still tied at two. Still in there. Pat Kelly to lead it off. The number nine hitter for the Yankees. He is 0-for-2, having flied to left and struck out as he tries to one play on. He fouls it off. Then it'll be the top of the order, Steve Sachs and Roberto Kelly.
Tell you, Roy Smith has been just outstanding. This is a real shot in the arm for Johnny Oates and the pitching staff, starting pitching staff for the Orioles.
Base hit into left field. And it may get by. No, Orsulak cuts it off. But Kelly is still going to have a double. The Orioles had both the first and third baseman on the line to guard against the extra base hit. So Pat Kelly got one to the center of the field.
Johnny Oates has his bullpen ready. He was just trying to see if Roy Smith could get through the inning, just give him a chance maybe to pick up a win. He's not going to waste any time. Todd Kroeworth, who was throwing earlier, the right-hander submariner, is going to be coming in.
So the Yankees have the potential winning run and scoring position with nobody out here in the eighth inning. A good seven innings plus for Roy Smith, however, to this point. Only charged with the two runs, the home runs to Mel Hall and Steve Sachs. So while the change is made, we'll take a break and return to New York in just a minute. Welcome back, where we've had three home runs in this game, so the cash register at Yankee Stadium has opened to close three times so far, contributing to that 45 grand. And here's Todd Froworth in relief of Roy Smith.
Yeah, frustrating watching Roy Smith because he knows right now he can't get a win. But he can get a loss because that runner out there belongs to him. Todd Froworth's job to try to shut things down. Steve Sachs has a job to do. He had a little conversation, too. Stump Merrill called Sachs over near the on-deck circle while Froworth was warming up and talked to Sachs, probably talked about where he wanted to drop down a bunt or if he even maybe wanted to swing away and try to send a ground ball to the right side.
Leo Gomez in on the edge of the grass at third base for the Orioles. Milligan creeping in at first, and Sachs squaring but taking high. Ball one.
See your option here. You can go up the third baseline and make Gomez field the bunt. There's no chance at all to get the runner. Keep in mind, Pat Kelly in second has good speed. You can also push one, because rarely do you see a first baseman make a play and throw to third, because it's difficult for the third baseman to backpedal and get there.
Right. You saw Roy Smith in the dugout. Sachs bunts it in the air, caught in fair territory by Gomez. And so the Yankees unable to advance Pat Kelly to third with one out. Sachs probably should have laid off that pitch. It was another high fastball.
Well, that's the last thing Sachs wanted to do, is pop it up. And Froworth did his job because he wanted to keep the fastball up to get the pop fly. See if he gets the bat out far enough. He doesn't really get the bat out far enough. Because he had it back and that pitch was up, the pop fly. Try to get that bat head a little bit more in front of the plate.
So one out. Kelly remaining at second for Kelly. Roberto the hitter. And there he goes to third. And the pitch bounces off the glove of Hoyles. And Pat Kelly steals third.
I tell you, you could see it in Pat Kelly when he was dancing around second base. You knew after Sachs failed to sacrifice him to third, then he was going to try to pick up a steal. He got a good jump, and because he got the good jump, Hoyle tried to rush things and never caught the ball.
Fourth stolen base in five attempts for Hoyle. So the sacrifice didn't work, but the Yankees still have runner in scoring position. The infield in. A swing and a miss by Kelly.
Infield in, and second base umpire Rick Reed playing shallow center.
The only call he's going to have to make under these circumstances are whether or not the catch is made in the outfield. Well, he's getting a jump. One and one to Kelly. Ball two. There's Rick Reed.
You know, you play that slow pitch softball, you have the rover.
Well, that's your 10th man right
yeah,
there.
Give Rick a glove, and, you know, he'll take everything shallow.
Baylor used to play everybody. And that's Don Baylor.
Bates hit. Kelly scores, and the Yankees take a 3-2 lead.
Tribute that run to some young Yankees. We talked about Roberto Kelly before, but it was started by Pat Kelly. And with that infield in, it's always tough. All you do is put the ball on the ground. Sounds easy. But the Orioles almost got a break. That ball hit sharply and hit off the mound. Sometimes that ball will carry him over to the second baseman.
Well, the infield's back, obviously, is a fairly easy play, although the ball was sharply hit. Roberto Kelly with his second hit of the day and his 36th RBI of the year breaks the tie. It's 3-2 Yankees, another change, and we'll be back. Don Mattingly will be the hitter as the Yankees have taken a one-run lead here in the eighth. And Mike Flanagan, for his 31st appearance, comes on in relief as Todd Froworth only lasts one-third of an inning. And the run, of course, charged to Roy Smith.
Talking about comebacks, everybody was focused on Jim Palmer in spring training, and it was Mike Flanagan who has really turned things around and done a good job all year.
Mattingly takes high and away, ball one. Donnie is 0 for 3. He has lined to center and then flied out to center with other two at bat.
The only adjustment Flanagan's had to make is that these were situations he was usually used to creating himself at times. Now he comes into situations that others have created.
High again, ball two. One out, Roberto Kelly at first. Pat Kelly led off the inning with a double to left center. Steve Sachs tried to bunt him to third, but popped out. So Pat Kelly stole third, and Roberto Kelly singled him home. Mattingly fouls it off. 2-1. Jim Palmer is here tonight, or today, brother. He on the right, and Brooks Robinson on the left. Couple of Hall of Famers right there broadcasting for the Orioles.
Well, that's the Hall of Fame booth. What's our booth?
The Hall of Shame, especially the way I'm talking today. I've got my mind in reverse. A minute ago, I said Don Baylor played shallow center field. Paul Blair is who I was trying to say. Former Oriole center field for many years when Palmer was pitching. Palmer has some great stories to tell about Blair.
Mattingly with a drive down the line. Foul ball. Only a few feet foul. 2-2.
You hang that pitch and get it in. That's what Mattingly is going to do. Flanagan's just saying, tell us, a strike. A long strike.
A well-hit strike.
Mattingly saying keep it fair. You can really tell the difference in his swing, though, compared to the second part of last year and even early in this year. Good weight shift. Good pop in his back.
Did he go too far? No, says Joe Brinkman, the third base umpire. 3-2.
Oh, he's telling himself. Motioning with his hands. Stay back. Got out a little bit too much on that last pitch, and he was able to hold back on the swing.
And you being a former left-handed hitter know how tough that can be against a left-handed pitcher sometimes.
Flanagan with a good move, too.
Well, the pitch before, he had Roberto Kelly going back to first base on the delivery home. Another one down the right field line.
Sub-Merrill really has the Yankees hustling, and I was watching Roberto Kelly on that line drive, and it was well fouled. Mattingly knew it was foul all the way, but Kelly, as soon as he saw that ball hit, just took off. Really didn't stop until he got a couple of steps from second base, but he realized it was foul.
That's the way the game ought to be played. Take nothing for granted. Throw to second, in time. A high throw, but Ripken able to get the tag down. And a strike him out, throw him out, double play, ends the inning here in the eighth. But the Yankees, on a steal. steal of third by Pat Kelly, and an RBI base hit by Roberto Kelly. Take a 3-2 lead.
Kind of a strange play. Not a good jump by Roberto Kelly. Mattingly tried to check his swing, but couldn't this time. And a heads-up throw.
We will go to the ninth with the Yankees battling back, a lead by one. Fishing is another good pastime for the 4th of July. I don't know how many fish you can find at Yankee Stadium, but a lot of people who sit in that particular section behind the screen above home plate bring the nets. Try to get those foul balls that come back so often. Tell you what, there's some fierce competition going on here.
Eric Plunk is still out there. One of the reasons the Yankees have done what they've done this year after the eighth inning because of that bullpen, but normally it's not Plunk in this situation. He doesn't have a save this year. He only has 8 saves in his major league career. But he was so tremendous in the eighth inning. 1-2-3 innings. Stump Merrill decided to keep him out there.
Milligan fouling it into the upper deck for strike one. Here in the ninth for Baltimore, down by one. It'll be Milligan, Gomez, and Hoyles, the three scheduled hitters.
By the way, that kind of shows you the versatility of the bullpen. Catteray has a save. Steve Farr leads. He has 12, but Lee Guterman has 4. John Havian with 1. Steve Howe has a couple.
That's that situational bullpen. Farr's the main guy, but Stump Merrill not afraid to put closing a game in the hands of others depending on
well,
the
that's
situation.
Right. Some will knock the so-called bullpen by committee. Just saying, well, it's a bullpen that doesn't have anybody that's any good to close. In this case, I don't think that's the case because they have some good arms out there.
I think Stump Merrill really believes they've got 3 or 4 guys who are good enough to close, and he uses them.
And one of the teams I was just reading about referring to is the Montreal Expos. Bullpen by committee. It hasn't been a successful committee.
No.
The committee's been on recess.
Just a little bit too tight, 2-2. Milligan has singled and scored and flied out his other 2 at-bats, 1-for-3. First win of the year. He is 0-2. And there is Leo Gomez on deck. Jeff Johnson pitched the first 7, but he left and the score was tied at 2. No decision. Ball 4. Milligan's patience pays off, and the Orioles have the potential tying run aboard with nobody out in the ninth.
Probably all he wanted to see if Plunk could get through things and close this out himself to pick up the win. With 25 walks in 42 innings, that's always been the downfall of Eric Plunk. Lee Guterman, left-hander, was warming up, and oddly enough, Stump Merrill is going to go with Guterman with right-handers coming up.
So it is Lee who will come into the game with nobody out of the ninth and the Yankees leading by 1. And to try to close it out, his 30th appearance of the season in a sparkling 1.89 ERA. Here's a look at the bullpen of the Yankees as we were discussing, Tommy.
Well, you can see that a lot of choices for Stump Merrill in the save department because of the way he had only 2 of that bullpen in the 2s in earned run average, Havian and Catteray. Steve Farr picked up a save last night. Last night, the Yankees defeated Cleveland. Farr pitched an inning. Pitched a couple of nights in a row, so that's probably the reason Guterman is on right here. Because right-handers are coming up. Normally, you would see Farr come in this game.
The Yankees are heavy on available left-handers. They also have Steve Howe needed. But right now, it's right-hander Leo Gomez as the hitter. Right-hander Chris Hoyle's on deck. Gomez 1-for-3. Ball 1.
Sometimes the manager will talk to his so-called closer, in this case Farr, who has the most saves. And we're just told that Farr, four out of the last five games, has pitched for the Yankees. So that's why he's getting the rest. Sometimes the manager will go before the game and just say, I'm not going to use you today.
Especially day game after a night game. Fly ball to center. Pat Kelly over toward left. Roberto Kelly. Second time I've done that. One away. And of course, hey, Milligan could, back to first.
Who said Don Blair? No.
Yeah, the way I'm going today, I couldn't say anything.
No, the choices are many for Stump Merrill.
I could have had Stump Merrill playing center field.
See, now you're getting me in trouble, though, because somebody just tuning in is wondering why I'm saying Don Blair.
Well, you had to know when you started working with me you were going to get in trouble anyway. I mean, that's part of the deal. Chris Hoyle's had a home run, his fourth of the year in the seventh. It is Chris Hoyle's, isn't it? He's one for three. And his home run, at the time, was pretty big. Retied the game after the Yankees had taken the lead with solo home runs in the fifth and the sixth inning.
That was a nice stroke, too. He was able to just tuck it into that right field bleacher area.
Grounded to short, and it could be two. Espinoza to Sachs to Mattingly. The Yankees win their sixth in a row. They have won nine of their last 10 games. Eric Plunk picks up his first win. And Lee Gutterman gets his fifth save with a double play ball here in the ninth. The Yankees now are only one game under 500.
And believe it or not, the Yankees 6.5 games now behind the Toronto Blue Jays, who lost this afternoon to the Minnesota Twins. So they're jumping and shouting here in the South Bronx. Lee Gutterman came in, the choice made by Stump Merrill. It didn't matter if he brought in the lefty or righty. Here's the big home run by Mel Hall. Mel Hall hit that home run in the fifth inning off Roy Smith. The curveball out over the plate. Steve Sachs with a stroke.
The Yankees with some power. And they come from behind to win it 3-2 for their sixth straight victory. Happy 4th of July, everybody. Thanks for being with us. Two more games to come. Steve Zabriskie for Tommy Hutton, sending you back to the studio on Gary Miller.
All right, thanks, Steve and Tommy. And the Bronx Bombers providing some fireworks of their own on this 4th of July. A couple of other afternoon games going on. Let's catch up on what's going on first in Wrigley Field, where the Cubs have exploded. They have an 8-3 lead on the Pirates as they play the 8th and try to avoid the sweep. And a game completed at Skydome. Minnesota avoids a sweep, and they regain the lead in the AL West. David West, just off the disabled list, combines in a three-hitter with Bedrosian and Aguilera to beat Jimmy Key, the only one in the game on a fielder's choice. We got more baseball throughout the night. We come back at 7 Eastern time. The other New York team, the Mets, are at Olympic Stadium in Montreal to take on the Expos, and then the night ends with the Dodgers and Padres from Jack Murphy. Brett Butler takes the game's longest hitting streak into that game at 17 straight. Mattingly's ended this afternoon. And as we've been tracking for you all day long, bring it up. 9 home runs so far, 7 in the majors, a couple in the minors, $45,000 contributed by Coca-Cola to the Star-Spangled Banner Monument. And that will have a monument for the flag in the nation's capital. They'll contribute at least $1 million to that campaign. And Orlando Merced has just hit a grand slam at Wrigley Field. That's the big old $5,000 to make it $50,000 now for the Coca-Cola contribution. John Saunders will be along at 7 Eastern to take you through the evening here on our 4th of July special triple header. The Yanks beat the Orioles by 1. Stay tuned for Major League Baseball Magazine.